Be a part of the best pro wrestling podcast today by supporting the Going In Raw Patreon. You can enjoy access to the live taping of the show, exclusive merchandise, and patron-only episodes, and so much more. Support Going In Raw today. Click the link in the description. Hey, friendo, Steve here.
And Larson.
And welcome back to Going In Raw. It is the wrestling. What are you doing over there? What are you looking at?
I'm getting my show notes ready.
You getting the show notes ready?
Yeah.
It's the wrestling podcast you guys need to be listening to. It's the only wrestling podcast you should be listening to. We're available here on YouTube, iTunes, Stitcher Radio, I'm sure. Oh, SoundCloud. We're on the SoundCloud. You can check us out there. Link's in the description. Now we're on, I think I'm still waiting for the response from Google Play, but apparently Google Play now does podcasts. We've been approved for Google Play. And we're going to be there soon, too, if not already.
And a bunch of other podcast apps we're apparently on, too.
That's right. Of course, we're also now doing Raw recaps on Tuesdays at Machinima. SmackDown NXT recaps on Fridays at Machinima. So even more of our asinine speculation, rumors, gossip, wrestling knowledge can be had over at the Machinima. Check it out.
Yeah, that's all pretty much true.
Yeah. Is there anything else? Oh, of course, our Patreon. We're now joined by 26 friendos here watching us live, the live stream version of this every Tuesday when we drop this at 3:00 in the Pacific. For $5 a month, supporting us, they can watch this live stream, interact with us. We have our first two ever video questions that will air live on this show.
Yeah.
And that's for the $20 plus patrons. They can subscribe to that level and put their faces on our show.
We should also mention that at the $5 level, weekly bonus episode. $1 level,
monthly bonus episode. The bonus episodes are my favorite because they're so goofy. We get really goofy. Now, I had one person ask, I think on Twitter or comments or something like that, is the $1 monthly bonus episode in addition to the weekly? No, it's just you get access to the week to one weekly episode per month.
It's usually the one
after a pay-per-view.
After a pay-per-view.
All right, not the Dan episode. We're going to do a bonus Dan episode.
No. Two pay-per-views this month.
We don't bug Dan more than we have
in
to.
In May. Sorry, there's two pay-per-views in May. So we have to decide which one they get.
Oh, dear. Yeah. My goodness gracious. Also, we just got these in for the $10 plus patrons.
Someone could step on that,
pick,
man.
Pick that up. Make sure. Oh, I just busted it up. We get these little Going In Raw postcards right here that I made. We're going to sign these. Send them out to the $10 and up patrons.
Who gets this one? It's all tore up.
You do. You son of a bitch.
I didn't even contribute. Thank you.
Larson, let's talk about Raw. It's time for...
Raw cap.
What a show. What a show. I don't know. Right?
It began like every other show the last 3 weeks. I don't know what was so spectacular.
Shane comes
about.
Out inexplicably. He's still running Raw. Apparently, social media is such a big sensation to the WWE.
Well, I guess like their Twitter trends and social media score are more important than ratings these days.
Do you think that?
Because that's what they're basing all their decision making on.
Do you think that they really thought that this shit was going to work? That they're going to have Shane O'Mac lose at WrestleMania and then ratings would skyrocket when he comes back after having lost? People are just confused over it. Yeah.
Do you know what's going to get better ratings?
What?
Good stories.
No, you know it's going to get huge ratings when Cena comes back. This is the shit. Look, this
it
is the,
won't be huge ratings.
It'll this
be
is the crappy
bump.
Thing.
It'll be a bump.
It'll be a big bump. Mm. He comes back Memorial Day. It's going to be a big bump, and it's going to. I'm sorry, but it's like Cena. The show kind of feels lost without Cena.
Well, let's wait. We're going to talk about Cena more in our bonus episode this week.
Will we? Okay. Yeah. Well, there you go. We're going to talk about Cena in our bonus episode. Was it $5?
$5 and up.
Gets to check that out. Okay, so Shane O'Mac comes out. He says, I'm in charge again. Thanks to all you guys. He gets a huge pop. Stephanie comes down, says, Daddy Vince is deciding at Payback who's going to be running Raw, Monday Night Raw. And we're going to find out then. She was intimating that she has it on good authority that it's going to be the authority back in charge. It seems like they're heading towards a brand split. I always feel weird when I say, I always feel like I'm saying bland split. But I'm saying brand split.
Yeah, that's correct. Brand split.
Well, somebody gets SmackDown, somebody gets Raw. I don't know why anybody wants SmackDown. It's a fucking recap show for Raw.
You know, last week there wasn't that many recaps. There's three, maybe.
Really?
Yeah, I didn't feel like it was too recap heavy.
Maybe you're right about that. SmackDown, I mean, it's starting to gain traction.
Yeah.
I want more stories exclusive to SmackDown. Maybe that's what this brand split's going to do.
Well, I think beyond that, we need more stories that have of consequence on SmackDown, whether they're exclusive to SmackDown or not. There's just nothing, you know, there's no stories of consequence happening on SmackDown.
More big twists and turns happening on SmackDown. Yeah. See, I want it to be its own thing, and I want Raw to be its own thing. Shared world champion.
If there's a brand split, it will be its own thing.
Right, exactly. That's what I'm thinking. That'd be good. So anyways, after that, we had AJ Styles versus Sheamus. I'm sorry, AJ Styles versus League of Nations member Sheamus.
Yes, we have to call him that until they break up.
Until they're officially broken up, yeah, according to Alberto Del Rio. Bullet Club got a little bit involved in this particular match. AJ ended up getting the win with a phenomenal forearm.
Yeah.
And we got to see, for the first time, Bullet Club's new gear.
Yeah.
And it looks exactly like their Bullet Club gear, only without Bullet Club all over it. But it's like...
They have the same font on it, though. Like on the knee pads, it's the Bullet Club font.
It is. Everything about it is Bullet Club. What is that cool gas mask that Gallows has?
Yeah, well, they both had it on the... Didn't Anderson have that on his rear end?
Oh, he had it on his butt?
I think so.
That's kind of funny.
Well, they both had it in the back of their entrance gear.
I don't know. It'd be kind of cool. Like, what if that's how Finn Balor debuted?
In a gas mask?
Like a gas mask?
And then he goes in payback and attacks AJ Styles. And like, who is the man in the gas mask?
But it's obvious, like, he has his demon stuff on.
Well, then he has his Fonz jacket on and it says, hey.
And he still has the NXT belt, even though he just lost it. Actually, it was kind of a decent match. I'll be honest with you. Yeah. I was watching that match and I was like, not a bad match to kick off Raw.
Yeah.
AJ won, Bullet Club. We got to see what they were doing. Backstage with Roman Reigns.
Yeah.
He was watching the match. Studying his opponent for payback.
Yeah, I guess so.
He always has that dulled look on his face.
I kind of like that, isn't it?
Anyways, the Usos came in. They were confusing me, man. They just kept on calling everybody Us. They said, hey, Us, check it out, Us. But they were pointing at Roman. I was like, why are they calling him Us?
I don't get it either.
And he's not an Uso. He's Roman Reigns.
Yeah.
So that doesn't make any sense to me.
I don't know.
They come in, start harassing Roman Reigns, saying the Bullet Club. I'm sorry, we've already recapped the Cypher Machine.
Yeah, I know.
So like, you're getting a loopy version of it right now.
We've literally been holed up in your office. It's about 10:30 this morning.
What was your favorite line that Roman said when talking to the Usos?
Sometimes the all needs help from the one.
It didn't make a lick of fucking
sense.
It
was literally like he had just watched Star Trek II, The Wrath of Khan.
Yeah, exactly.
And heard what Spock said.
Yeah, but jumbled
about
it.
The needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few or the one. And then just kind of got confused. And then just said that.
He didn't quite understand what Spock was getting at there. I was confused that he killed himself. Let's see here. So, yeah, that happened. And then this cracked me up because you have, like, Roman and the Usos, and they're just boring the crap out of everybody. And these guys collectively get booed so fucking hard. Nobody wants anything to do with them, right?
I mean, I guess during that segment, my power went out. Yeah. I'm kind of thankful.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I read what happened. You told me what happened, too.
There's nothing. And then...
But in my mind, I could speculate about what really happened.
And it's probably more entertaining in your mind. And then this part kind of cracked me up because you have these three black holes of charisma on the screen just sucking the life away, literally taking the power from your house.
Yeah.
And then it cuts to the entrance ramp and the New Day's music hits. They come down and it's like, oh, thank God. Somebody with actual personality, somebody with actual charisma comes down. And they deliver a killer promo once again,
yeah,
making everybody laugh.
I missed that too.
The vaudevillains interrupt them.
Missed that.
Once again, when their music kicks in, it's like nothing. It's like silence. It's like somebody just turned off all the mics and the noise and the crowd noise. They just sort of stroll out and you realize, oh, somebody's playing some music too. They just stroll out there. Anyways. Yeah. They come out.
Look. And you didn't notice about their music, whether the piano came back, right?
No, I didn't. I know I was, it's funny because I think I was paying attention, but, and then I stopped paying attention and I forgot.
See, I was going to pay attention, but then I didn't see it because the power went out.
Yeah. So anyways, the New Day, or the vaudevillains come out. They talk some shit. Then Enzo and Cass comes out and they get just the biggest flip and pop. And it's funny because like, So the Vaudevillains music, I guess tempo, you're more of a music guy than me. The difference between the Vaudevillains music and Enzo and Cass's music.
In terms of the tempo?
In terms of tempo, in terms of like getting out of your seat, I think there's not that huge of a difference.
In terms of the actual beats per minute, probably not.
Right. But I think that is. I think it's the excitement of Enzo and Cass, isn't it?
No, I mean, their music has attitude to it.
It has a little attitude to it, yeah.
Isn't that Enzo rapping on it? It sounds like it.
Once the music kicks in, like, because there's like the Italian, what is it, the mandolin or something like that?
Yeah, I know what you're talking about, yeah.
Right, that kicks in, but then he starts rapping after that.
Yeah.
But when that first kicks in, people go crazy, and well, I think it's just because it's Enzo and Cass.
They know what it means.
It's Enzo and Cass. Yeah. I mean, that goes a long way, you know, who it is. It's interesting that their personalities are so transcendent that they can overcome a weak entrance.
No, I think their entrance song is great. Just that, I know that little intro, I know what you're talking about.
You know what I'm talking about, though. The little intro gets people going because they know who it is.
They know what's coming next.
Not necessarily. Like, if that was my entrance music, like if they'd be sitting on their hands.
If their whole song was that little bit of music.
Yeah, that's a good point.
It would be like the Vaudevillains entrance. It would just be, you know, a single instrument playing.
Anyways, they come down. They have some more great back and forth with the Vaudevillains. Enzo delivered the line of the night.
Which I did see.
When he said... like the Vaudevillains say something like, we're going to take the number one contendership, we're going to take the titles. And then Enzo says, I'd love to run on the beach into my own arms, but that's impossible. Oh my God, that was fucking hilarious.
Yeah, he's good.
I thought that was absolutely hilarious. And everybody, like, I got on Twitter and everybody was talking about it. So that was a lot of fun. And then the New Day said, it doesn't matter because we're going to keep our titles anyways, which I think is probably going to happen, to be completely honest with you. Who do you see going over?
I kind of feel like at Payback, the Dudleys are going to screw over Enzo and Cass, and the Vaudevillains will advance.
We didn't see the Dudleys this week on Raw.
They're on SportsCenter tonight.
Oh, okay. So they're still in the eye. They're still in the mix.
Yeah.
I think you're right about that. That's we're in agreement on that. Vaudevillains go over. I think they're going to lose to the New Day, though. Unless they try that shit. You know what's funny? Is that those belts actually work perfectly for the Vaudevillains.
They do.
Because they look like old-timey belts.
They do.
But not in a good way. I don't really like the way they look.
They're not good-looking belts.
After that, we got the debut of the Bullet Club.
Yeah, in-ring debut
of the Bullet Club. WWE can not use the word Bullet Club all they want, but they're the Bullet Club.
Yeah.
And everybody in the crowd starts chanting Bullet Club when they come out.
Yes.
And they look like the Bullet Club. That's kind of clever on the WWE's part. Like, they couldn't obtain the rights to it.
Is clever really the word, though?
Well, okay, they're not actively calling them something else. They're not actively trying to shape them into something else.
No, I know.
I mean, if you want to call them lazy for just not referring to them as anything but Anderson and Gallows, or Gallows and whatever they call them.
Yeah.
That's fine. I'm just saying, like, too often they jump the gun and they try to make them into something else. Or they're probably just waiting for Balor Club.
That, I think. But also, I don't know how much... I think, by and large, the talent decide what their entrance gear is.
Uh-huh.
I think within the packaging of the character, that's decided between talent and WWE. So it could just be a thing where, like, okay, you guys are going to be, for now, Anderson and Gallows. Mm-hmm. And they're like, well, we like what we wore in New Japan. We just want to do that.
Yeah.
That could just be what it is.
I wonder if that's exactly how the meeting went down. We like what we did there. We want to do that.
We're going to do that.
And then Gallo said, like, whatever you do, just don't make me Festus again. Anyways, oh, by the way, did you see? No longer available on ProWrestlingTees.com.
I wish I had gotten the Shinsuke Nakamura King of Strong Style shirt.
I know, me too. I've looked for it. You can get it on, I think somebody, like, recreated on, like, what is it? Redbubble?
Oh, yeah.
Or is that the porno site? No, it's RedTube. I don't know. Anyways, I think you can get a recreation of it. Let's see here. After that, so they had a match against Usos. This kind of, I was kind of not huge on this match. Only it was a good match. It was a decent match.
I was really happy with, like, the first hour of Raw.
Mm-hmm.
There was three matches, and a couple promos, but they just let the matches have time.
Yeah,
they kept most of the talking bits short.
I thought this would have been, and I know they're not looking to bury the Usos. Quite the opposite. But I think this would have been more effective in establishing the Bullet Club if this would have been like a 3-minute squash match, DQ with weapons. Like, if they just would have said, fuck it, we're not necessarily here to pick up wins. We don't really care about that. We want to destroy these guys and make a message, and that's what we care about. Mm-hmm. And so if I mean, this was like a 3-minute squash match where they just destroyed them using, you know, by cheating,
yeah,
I think that would have been more effective than just giving them a straight-up match like they did.
Well, I think, I mean, it was a straight-up match, but the Bullet Club, by and large, dominated the match. They were in control a vast majority of it.
Yeah. And, I mean, as a showcase for them, it was really good because yeah. they are a really, really, really good tag team. And I love that they play them up so much. I love that they play their new Japan stuff up. Yes. I mean, they straight up mention they're the IWGP champions 3 times. I love that they talk about their history. I think that's great. I mean, they're playing into the whole Bullet Club thing yeah. without saying the announcers Club. Saying their yeah. name. I think that's yeah. great. Let's see here. After that, okay, so Anderson, Gallows go over. Roman Reigns come out because they start beating the crap out of after the bell's rung and their hands have been raised. They start beating the living tar out of the Usos, you know, extracurricular activities. Roman Reigns comes out, save the day. They scamper flee. Off. They flee, which made yeah. them look kind of weak, right?
Yeah. We'll get back to people fleeing and having them look weak later.
And battling Stardust later. We've got 2 guys on the ground. 1 guy comes out. They should be able to take him down. That's what kind of bugs me.
I know.
That.
I agree.
But, you know, they're trying to do I said earlier, I'm not sure it's the Bullet Club is the hottest thing right now. They're not going to be able to get Roman Reigns over by taking him on. It's not going to happen.
No.
Doesn't matter what they fucking do. Let's see here. Like, the stronger Roman Reigns looks, this is the thing. The stronger Roman Reigns looks, the weaker he's going to be in the eyes of the fans.
Yeah.
The less they're going to want. You want your hero to be beat down, to be broken. Yeah. Look at every modern fucking movie. Every movie where you've got your underdog character.
They have to battle through adversity.
I mean, it's just conflict.
Yeah.
It's just basic storytelling.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
All right. Then they had a really, really good video package for Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn, detailing their history. They go back so far. They're best friends.
They had something similar at NXT during mm-hmm. their feud there, too.
Yeah. And because they have a match coming up at Payback. Who do you see going over Payback? This is kind of an interesting one. You see Sami Zayn taking this, or is this sort of match one of many matches where Sami Zayn eventually comes out on top, but he might lose this one? Because this doesn't feel like a blow-off match.
Yeah.
Up.
Well, I could see this match happening, and then there's Extreme Rules is next, and then
they have to do something big at Extreme Rules with one-on-one.
And then after that's Money in the Bank, and I'd be surprised if both of them were not in the Money in the Bank ladder match. So I can see that.
I said Owens is my Money in the Bank winner, didn't I?
Yeah.
Yeah, I still stand by that.
So that could be. It could be a situation where Owens wins Sunday, Sami Zayn wins at Extreme Rules,
mm-hmm.
and then Owens, you know, somehow screws or prevents Sami Zayn from getting the briefcase and he wins it. And so what's the July pay-per-view? Battleground?
Oh, I don't know.
I don't remember. What are the July pay-per-view they can... And they could hypothetically take it up all the way to SummerSlam if they wanted to.
I'm going to say...
And they could. There's enough material to work with.
So who do you say is going to go over Payback?
I'll say Kevin Owens.
I'll just to split it, I'll go Sami Zayn. Okay. Because I think it'd go either way. But I do think that
I think it could too.
I do think it's going to go way further past. It's probably going to culminate at SummerSlam,
yeah.
you know?
Yeah. That's August.
It's 3 months. They could do that. Yeah. All right, let's see here. After that, we had an Apollo Snooze interview. Who did he talk to? What did he do?
Talk to Renee Young.
Oh, yeah, and then Stardust comes up. He starts talking about Dusty Rhodes. Stardust says he's up on that talk. Then they have a match.
Yeah.
Apollo goes over Stardust pretty easy.
Yeah.
I wake up because I took a big fat nap during that one. Happy robot, man. Happy robot. One day he's going to be like, I'm goal-oriented. Take off his face, robot stuff underneath. Then that'd pick me up. Happy robot. What?
Nothing.
Nothing? You got nothing to add to that?
No, I mean, I still enjoy Apollo Crews. I like his work.
One day you're going to get bored of him, but you're not going to admit that you're bored of him.
No, I will.
All right. Ambrose and Jericho had a promo, which I love.
Great.
I am loving Chris Jericho's work. I think he's being paired up perfectly with Ambrose. I love it. I love when he calls people stupid idiots.
Mm-hmm.
I love when he says, I am the best in the world at what I do. Are you paying attention to what I am saying?
I like his boots line.
Yeah, the boots one was good.
$1,500 boots.
$750 a boot. and that old thing, Ambrose was on fire too.
Yeah.
He was really good.
His, I'm sorry this, but I'm not sorry. Mm-hmm. I'm going to do this.
Really good. And you know what? Usually when they hit him with the microphone, it always looks kind of weak. Somehow Ambrose, like, it looked like he had velocity from a standing point. Like, it looked like he didn't have to build it up. He just, like, went into it. It looked really cool. Like, they both sold it really, really well.
Most people hold the mic by the stem of the mic.
It was this.
And he holds it by the mic cover.
Or was it this? I think he had a finger on the
thing.
That could
be.
Yeah. Anyways, it ended up with Ambrose in the Walls of Jericho on the announce table. And I kind of like that. I like that it was Ambrose initiated the physical violence and then Jericho turned it around on him and had him in the submission. I like that a lot. That was good. After that, we had my favorite wrestler, my favorite female wrestler right now, Emma, because she looks so ridiculous in that outfit. She has the aviators. She has like she still has the WrestleMania gear.
She has a little half gloves.
The weird finger gloves.
And she had shoulder pads when she came out.
The shoulder pads. It's all just a mess.
I always feel like when she goes through the ropes to get into the ring with her shoulder pads, she did that last night where she arranged her shoulder pads so they didn't get caught on the ropes. Did you notice that?
Yeah. I've seen that before.
And she smiled at least once during that match.
I tell you, she smiled twice. Outside when they were fighting, and
yeah, that's one I think
I thought. I swear to God, I saw a smile when she was in the sharpshooter, which is like that's not a maneuver you're supposed to smile at.
No, not at all.
But she seems like very happy to be there. Like, and then Charlotte referred to her as Evil Emma.
I know.
That's great.
She's probably smiling when
she probably was.
Charlotte said that too.
Let's see here. So that'll be a lot of fun. I don't see. This is the kind of feud they've built up really, really nicely to make me think Natalya could win. They got Bret Hart coming out, but I don't think it's going to happen. I think long game, Charlotte's going to keep this belt for a long time.
Yep, till at least SummerSlam.
It looks great on her. I would not be sad. I would not be upset at all if Natalya picked up the belt at Payback, though, because you know maybe just for a month or something.
Yeah.
I don't think it's going to happen. I wouldn't be upset at all. Then they spent about 2 minutes showing tweets about China. As their memorial.
They didn't have any interview material, did they?
It was all just tweets.
You know, I wonder if that it was the case because, you know, like most, I'm sure, you know, when they do sit-down interviews for documentaries, they might just do a bunch of them at one time.
Yeah.
Yeah, like on the upcoming docket, we got, just because I know this is what's coming out, we got like the Dudley Boys DVD just came out and the Scott Hall one just came out.
Oh, yeah.
And so they'll take, you know, a superstar and sit them down and say, hey, can you talk about these people?
Yeah.
And I'm just wondering, since China's been gone from the company so long and hasn't really been on good terms with them.
I think you're right, yeah.
If they just don't have the interview footage of people talking about it.
I think you're probably right about that. I mean, it would have been nice. It would have been nice, like, and I
would have thought they would have had enough time to at least do something, you know, sit Triple H down or Stephanie or somebody down.
Wouldn't that be something if they had Triple H and Stephanie sitting down next to each other talking up about China? That'd be fucked up. I feel like there should have been like a better, lengthier video like tribute to her.
Oh, yeah.
Like with the, not even with the interview, just a song or something. I don't know. I felt like it was. I mean, hey, you know what? They acknowledged her.
Yeah. They had the in memory card at the beginning of the show.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then they had the package in the middle.
So. I really do hope that this is sort of step one of them getting her into the Hall of Fame 2017, though. Let me ask you something. I think she would definitely be a headliner, but do you think they would ever headline? Have they headlined somebody who passed?
When Macho Man went in, he was not the headliner. Kevin Nash was.
Wow. So there's not a chance she's going to be a headliner. Who would induct her?
Well, you can have any of the DX people.
Any of the DX people, yeah. Boy, that'd be weird. I really do hope 2017 is her year, though. It's a bummer.
Or you could have Lita or Trish Stratus.
That's what I was thinking. Like, yeah, somebody in the female, or even somebody like current.
Mm-hmm.
Like
Chris
Charlotte.
Jericho.
Oh, Jericho would be fucking great. Yeah. That's a good one right there. Let's see here. Sandow. Oh, here we go. This is great. So then it cuts to
away from Dolph Ziggler.
Just wait a second. Just wait. I know you're horny to lay in on Baron Corbin, but
no,
I'm not horny to lay into him.
I'm horny to lay into his booking because it was
awful. And his booking. No, see, I like his booking.
No, this is terrible.
Okay, well, I'm going to trump you in a second.
Explain what happened.
Damian Sandow's in the ring.
Yeah.
And we're like, fuck yeah, we got a Damian. And then they start talking about Baron Corbin. It's like, okay, well, Corbin's going to run through Sandow and Dolph will. Okay, that's fine. Or I was thinking maybe Dolph was going to fight him. And, you know, Sandow's being used. He literally got one shot of him in the ring.
Yeah.
And then it cuts to Baron Corbin's awesome entrance.
He's got a new entrance.
Yeah, he's got the red lights, but he still has a spotlight, so he knows where to go.
But they're red spotlights now.
Because he can't be bothered
to memorize a mark.
I love it. Anyways, he comes out. Dolph Ziggler's back there with his PS4 controller. He hits X.
He breaks out.
Wait, is it X on the PS4
controller?
It is X. Okay. He hits X to break out. Comes running up behind him. And it was staged exactly like a 2K16 breakout.
Yeah, where Dolph just showed up.
He just showed up, runs out behind him, decks him, and Corbin runs away. Okay, so you're fine and well when Kevin Owens
leaves a fight. I'm really not fine with that. But also, it's been established as his character. At no point that I can remember in his days at NXT or his short run so far in WWE has Baron Corbin ever run away from a fight.
I don't know. I think you're right about that.
And it made him look weak. Because Dolph is my size, basically.
He's not your... He's taller. He's got to be 6'5".
Dolph?
You don't think Dolph is
6'5"? He's 5'11 at most.
Really?
Yes.
He's like Daniel Bryan size?
No, Daniel Bryan's like 5'8".
I think you're crazy.
Look it up. Look up how big Dolph Ziggler is. I think he's 5'10", 5'11", 185. Something like that. 6'5"?
6 feet.
Okay, 6 feet.
He's 6 feet. So he's my size.
Okay.
And Baron Corbin's 6'8"?
6'8".
Look, somebody runs up behind you, starts pummeling on you. Like, he probably went to HR and was like, Dan Bryan's 5'10".
Okay, he's my height then. He's shorter than me.
He probably went to HR and was like, hey, I didn't realize this was part of my I didn't know people could do that.
Does he think it's real?
Huh? It wouldn't surprise me, like, given how he talks sometimes. Look, the best wrestlers are the ones that think it's real. Scott Steiner is the most entertaining wrestler. You know he owns a restaurant?
Yeah, I know. You showed me the video.
Did you see a picture of him in the restaurant with, the NWO?
No, I didn't see that.
There was a picture of, it was, like, Nash, Hall, Steiner. And they, except for Nash and Hall, which we've gotten a good look at quite a bit. Oh, Buff Bagwell was there. Buff Bagwell was not recognizable. Maybe it's just because of what he was wearing.
Yeah.
They were all sitting down on the waiting area bench.
Yeah.
Scott Steiner had a shirt and tie on. And then, and his brother and Rick Steiner was there. Looks nothing like he looks healthy. He looks good.
Yeah.
Doesn't look fat or anything.
Doesn't he do?
He's a real estate guy, I think. Yeah. Yeah, I think he's actually more fit than he is. Like, he just has like a fit older guy body.
Yeah.
Anyways, I think if my memory is correct, I don't know, he could be wildly out of shape.
That's funny.
But it didn't look like him at all. It was like it's because I remember with the thing and then the big giant Fu Manchu.
Yeah.
Scott Steiner. Anyways, where are my show notes? Oh, here we go. Who do you see going over Payback, Corbin versus Dolph? Because it was officially announced as being a match.
Yeah, Corbin's going to go over.
You think so? I think so too. You think this feud is going to keep going or no?
No.
Dolph is going to move on and job to the next guy?
Yeah.
Probably, huh? Poor Dolph Ziggler. Let's see here. What happened next? Oh, yeah. Yeah, basically you could have just turned off the rest of the time. Miz TV. Here's the thing. I said this before. I've said this a million times before. I like Miz.
Mm-hmm.
I always try to look at the positive. I like Miz when he is not a champion.
Yeah.
B, doing Miz TV, instigating other feuds. He works really well as sort of a Jerry Springer type.
Yeah.
When he brings other people on, because his facial reactions to when people burn each other verbally
are
hilarious.
Yeah.
When he does that kind of stuff, that's great.
I know.
He's
really
so good at that. He hasn't been a legitimate threat as in terms of his power rankings, his points, whatever you want to call him. He hasn't been a legitimate threat for such a long time, and it would take a lot for me ever to care about him as a legitimate threat. But just as an instigator, he's really good.
Yeah, he is.
Which is why I really, and I honestly think at Payback, Cesaro's not going to win the belt. I think this is going to last a little bit longer. This might be one of those things. You know how sometimes they keep the belt on people that just annoy you for way too long?
Yeah.
I have a feeling this is going to happen.
Yeah.
I really just get that feeling.
That would be a bummer.
It'd be a huge bummer. I would love to see Cesaro get the belt and do something interesting with it.
Yeah.
I just don't know what's going to happen. And this segment was terrible. Miz kept on reciting all these lines. It was just, it was bad.
Yeah. It was not good.
Let's say here. Then Roman Reigns. Well, Roman Reigns and AJ had a backstage moment.
Oh, yeah, where grumpy AJ went up to him and said, I'm going to take your belt at Payback.
Is this where he turned his hat?
Yeah.
He flipped the switch like Sylvester Stallone did in Over the Top.
Yeah.
So he flipped the switch, and then he said, I'm going to take your world title. He has that southern accent. Your world title.
Yeah.
He was going to take his world title. And then Reigns was like,
Said, oh, that means you just bought ringside tickets for Anderson and Gallows.
Yeah.
They work there.
They're on the roster.
Yeah, they work there. They don't have to buy tickets.
Yeah, I'm going to buy tickets for them. Yeah. Let's see here. Then we had Reigns versus Del Rio. I'm sorry. Roman Reigns versus League of Nations member Alberto Del Rio. Bullet Club interfered. Reigns still picked up the win. AJ sort of backed the Bullet Club off Roman Reigns. Roman Reigns gives him
a Superman punch.
Which AJ responds to with
a phenomenal forearm.
That's right.
So the show ends with AJ, I guess, on top.
This is I really like how they built this.
Yeah.
I'll be honest with you. I mean, if we're stuck with Roman as champion, okay, build up a good storyline around him. And maybe if you start writing him the correct way, I'll start understanding and appreciating the character more and being into him as a champion.
Well, this whole Bullet Club saga that's been going on is more or less the A story on the show. Roman, however, is a kind of a bit player in that story.
It's mainly about like how the Bullet Club is dealing with this new dynamic of all them being in the WWE. It'll be really interesting. Now, you don't believe we're going to see Finn Balor at... I'm sorry, no, I don't think they're going to see Finn Balor. You think Finn Balor's going to show up at Payback?
Yeah, because the Chicago crowd will go absolutely crazy for him.
I think...
And it'll make him look like a huge star.
I think my personal opinion is they're going to wait because I think they've been rolling out this story at a deliberate pace, which I really like, and I think that would be too soon. I do think they're going to turn on AJ... They might even slow it down so much so that they're going to cost him the belt, but in a way that just makes him start questioning them a
bit
more.
Possible.
And then we're going to get Finn Balor down the line.
That's entirely possible.
Here's one thing you can definitely understand or agree on. Do not trust Finn Balor when he tweets, when he says, I'm going to be here or there or anywhere.
I'll see you Monday.
Because for months... He's been teasing his Raw debut, and then he loses his belt to Samoa Joe, and he says, clear as day, I'll see you guys Monday. But then he shows up at another show, and he says, I'm here to stay in NXT. The bottom line is, I think he likes playing with people.
Oh, yeah.
And he likes teasing him coming up. I think he has to get the biggest kick out of the fact that people are so anxious for him to come up to the main roster. That's got to be a lot of fun
for
him.
Yeah, I'm sure it is.
So... and then you also have your, Cena, John Cena, his return date is set.
Yeah. We talked about it a little bit ago.
Memorial Day.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
What was that May 20 something?
May 30th.
May 30th. Okay. There you go. And then, there's a little bit Del Rio in an interview. Was this a Spanish language interview?
I don't know.
Or in English? I don't know either.
I don't know.
But apparently he was kind of saying that they're done with League of Nations. I didn't even see the exact quote. I just saw the headline that said Del Rio says that they might be kind of done-ish.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
that's pretty much it.
Right on. Larson, we got a package from Mr. David Fishkind, and we're going to open that. I'm hoping it's something that we can stick up here on the wall.
I'm hoping that's the case, too.
We need something to open that.
I have
something.
Keys.
I have a key.
I have keys right here.
I have a key.
Whoops.
What if we open is like a hand in there? That'd be fucked up.
Oh, there's a letter.
Oh, nice.
You read that.
Okay.
Looks like we have some toys.
Hey, friendos. I wanted to send you guys something for your Going In Raw set for a bit of time, and
oh, nice.
So I decided to send Seth and Dusty some friendos for the Going In Raw. table. Look at that. Oh, viva la raza.
Eddie Guerrero.
Both of your enthusiasm for WWE got me intrigued early this year before the Royal Rumble. I want to say thank you for being my favorite and what I think is the best pro wrestling podcast around. David Fishkin, Dusty Club for life, baby.
Cesaro.
Oh, look at that. It's Cesaro. Nice. We're going to have to start building our stable up here. Thank you.
Love to get a ring.
Thank you very much, David. We really appreciate
that. Yes, thank you very much.
That's fantastic. Two of our favorite wrestlers here on the Going In Raw set. I loved Eddie, man. Eddie was, you met Eddie once, didn't you?
Did.
He was doing a signing at like a car dealership?
No, at an auto parts place.
Auto. That's even better, an auto parts
place. Yeah, it was hot, and he was not that happy to be there.
He had to be making a couple bucks, though, right?
Yeah, I was in the WCW days.
Yeah.
So it was probably 97, I want to say.
Okay.
Said hi.
A hot day.
Yeah.
Did he, was there anything, say anything to you?
Said hey.
Hey, Chico.
No, just said hey.
Just say hey.
He said, hey, what do you want on the picture?
See, that's autograph. What I want. That's what I'm trying to get out of you here. That's he said, hey, what do you want on the autograph?
Yeah, because he's personalizing them, you know?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
That's great.
Question time.
Time for questions.
First, Patrick Cheeseman.
Hey.
What are the chances of
Cheeseman? Sorry, go ahead.
What are the chances of Shane stay in charge post payback? Also, what's the best way to book a returning Seth Rollins?
I think Shane is going to stick around. I'm leaning towards they're going to do a brand split.
Mm-hmm.
You think they're going to do, let me ask this, dude. Do you think they're going to do a draft? They'd have to, right?
You'd think so.
They'd have to do a draft. What's the best way to book a returning Seth Rollins?
This is all assuming that they're going to follow through on the original rumor has it planned for Seth at WrestleMania, which was against Triple H.
Okay.
I'd say a match would take place at SummerSlam.
Okay.
And it'd probably be a situation where Seth comes out and says, you know, hey, I was your champ, and then you took it upon yourself, blah, blah, blah.
I would love that. Yeah,
Was I not good enough for you? Something like that, you know?
I want him to come out with the belt.
Or that too,
with his own belt.
That'd be great.
Yeah.
Toby Michaels, just watched Raw. That Roman make-a-wish kind of doesn't sit well with Toby Michaels. Like, he only did it to look good. Is he that toxic that Toby Michaels thinks that way?
I think maybe you're mixing your own personal feelings with how this shit's being written with the person, like, with them doing their charity stuff. I think it's great. Look, if he's bringing any joy to a kid who's going through some fucked up shit, then I think that's great. I think it's fantastic. There's a lot of people who still love Roman.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the crowd is turning on him big time, but I think the older crowd, it's sort of a Cena effect.
Oh, it definitely is, yeah.
You know, the older crowd who don't like, you know, sort of cut and dry superheroes, they want more complexity and all that kind of stuff, they're more prone to boo him.
Yeah.
But kids love Roman. He's a big superhero guy, you know? And so if he's, you know, I'm sure WWE has like a liaison with Make-A-Wish and they're like, hey, these kids over here really love Roman. Can he come out? So that's
fine. And
it
wasn't the first time that they've done something like that during Raw where one of the superstars will grant a wish to it when he's kids. And then during the course of the show, they'll show something about it and have him go to the kid and say hi and give him something like that, you know?
Yeah.
So it's happened before. So it's good of Roman to do that.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to in any way say anything ill about the guy.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure they look. They're all characters. They're all like, yeah, you know, they're all people.
Yeah. I mean, good on Roman for doing that stuff. Brady Douglas. Do you think the WWE will hesitate to induct China into the Hall of Fame to avoid seeming like they're flip-flopping?
No, I think.
I wouldn't be surprised if they waited a year.
Really?
Yeah.
I don't know. I think the pressure is going to be so on them.
Not that I think they're going to do it, but I wouldn't be surprised if they did wait a year.
I think the pressure is going to be so hardcore on them that they're going to have to. And I think that they will. I think that her death now takes precedent over her porn career.
How many years did they wait after? I mean, granted, I know there is issues between Macho Man's family in WWE, but it was a few, 2-3-4 years before they inducted him after his death.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, that was all held up by family stuff.
Yeah.
Though.
Max, where would AJ Lee fit in the new? I can't read right now. Max, where would AJ Lee fit among the new wave of women's wrestlers from NXT? She was a really good wrestler.
Yeah, she was a really good wrestler.
I think she'd be a great I guess not addition because she would have already been there.
I think that she was like she was around too early.
Yeah.
She was around at the wrong time, like way too late or slightly too early.
Yeah.
Because she'd be having a field day right now.
And she'd been great happening in the Attitude Era.
I always got the feel like I seem to remember when Paige came up, there was talk between the two of them that they really wanted to do a Hell in a Cell match.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think Paige was like the only person that she was like really like, man, it'd be great to work with.
Yeah.
So
yeah, that'd been cool.
Yeah.
Dustin Schna, which do you think would help the vaudevillains more? Their gimmick being turned up by 10 with a full circus vaudeville act?
Yeah.
Or just being rebranded?
No rebrand. Yeah. I think that would absolutely kill them. I think they look the part. Their gimmick is perfect. I love the idea of more of it. Yeah. I love that idea. I'll be honest with you, like, I'm totally cool with their whole thing.
It's just kind of the music.
It's honestly like when you hear music, you want to be like, and they're not the personalities like Enzo and Cass for people to associate. Oh man, this is going to be awesome.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah, I think if they just tweak the music, they'll be fine. Joshua Boteo. Hey, friendos.
Hi.
Have you guys seen how svelte Rusev has gotten? What has a man been doing? DDP yoga?
He's looking a little trim. He's
not looking a little bit trim. He's looking a lot trimmer.
No, he's not in DDP yoga territory, though. Like, when I see DDP yoga people, it's like, oh, like, dramatic, drastic difference. Like, they're all... And, yeah, no. But he looks good.
He looks great.
Good job.
Infrared Ruby, 421. Do you see Joey Ryan getting into WWE? And if so, does he win a title? I don't think he's going WWE. He's doing too well for himself in the indie circuit. Not anytime soon, at least.
My thing about Joey Ryan is kind of older.
Yes,
he's like around our age, I think.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. He's the kind of guy, number one, like you said, I think he's probably doing fine for himself.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure deep down, like everybody else, he'd probably be interested in testing it out. I wonder if he's doing so well right now, though, with a gimmick that just ain't going to work in the WWE.
Yes.
So, I don't know. Maybe, you know what? Maybe when he milks that gimmick for all his... Or it could be like an Adam Pearce type situation where he goes to train in NXT. Yeah. I could see that.
Yeah, that's possible. Another question from Infrared Ruby 421. Does Paige get a title again?
Adam Pearce or Adam Cole? Which one is it?
You're thinking of Adam Pearce.
Okay.
Does Paige get a title again, or is she stuck to be without the belt as long as she's on Total Divas? I just think they brought in all these new women.
Mm-hmm.
And they're...
Paige is still really young.
Yeah, she's 23.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
So she's got plenty of career left. She'll get plenty more title runs, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. She's like the Wyatts. She can be placed into the main event of that particular division anytime, and it's legit.
Yeah. Ashley Smith. Which tag team would you send to NXT? Apparently Ashley Smith is a he.
Mm-hmm.
Thinks the Dudley Boys would be great. By the way, I'm male. Last episode, you referred to me as a she.
What's your problem? Why would you do that? It's a he.
I didn't know.
How do you know it's you? Why did it me?
Probably because I'm the one that read questions.
Oh, yeah, good point. Which tag team would you send to NXT?
Sorry, actually, I didn't know. My apologies.
Accidents happen.
Yeah.
We apologize.
Yes. I don't know if I'd see the Dudleys in NXT.
Yeah, no, they're old. Which tag team would you send to NXT?
Would the Ascension qualify?
I wouldn't want them in NXT.
I know.
I wonder, do you think we would have been Ascension fans if we were watching at the beginning of their NXT run?
I don't know if that was their run in NXT was the problem so much as what they did in NXT, they just didn't bring up to Maine.
No, I agree with you. I agree with you. I'm saying while they're in NXT.
Oh, maybe like if we had gotten to know them
and
better.
Could you imagine? Like, we'd have been so jazzed. Oh, cool. They're coming. Oh, it's them. That's cool. And then just like seeing how they were booked.
Yeah.
Because they were booked so bad.
Yeah, they were.
I'd be on drugs too if I was booked that way.
42 Tesla. So the U.S. title means nothing right now. There's been basically zero mention of it since WrestleMania, except when the Lucha Dragons fought against the Dudleys. How do you guys book it so it's actually relevant?
John Cena.
The U.S. title is going to be defended again on the pre-show.
John Cena.
We got Kalisto versus Ryback. Payback pre-show.
John Cena.
Yeah, probably John Cena.
John Cena.
That'll be the way to revitalize it.
John Cena.
Grant Hancock.
Grant Hancock, baby.
If Bayley and Balor both come up and Balor turns heel, are they going to keep these two away from each other?
Baylor Club.
because they work really well together. Potential storyline with Balor having to choose between the old life with Bullet Club and new life with Bayley, or is WWE not that smart?
Kind of like a Sons of Anarchy situation where like they're like, you can either run with Anderson and Gallows, your old running buddies, or you got to stay home with the domestic life with me. No, I don't know. I don't see that. They're so different.
Yeah.
They're so different, and they're going to be doing such different things.
Yes.
You can get away with that at NXT. And even so, like, they play that up in, like, the house shows and in between, like, takes probably at the tapings.
Yeah, but I...
You don't really... I haven't seen
really
it on
see
camera.
The actual show, no. Yeah.
Hold on. So, no, I don't know. I don't
suspect they'll play that up at all.
I really doubt that.
All right, we got a couple video questions.
All right, here we go.
The first one is from Zach Humphrey.
Okay.
Are you guys looking forward to Camp WWE? If so, why?
Thank you, Zach Humphrey. That was our very first video question.
Yeah.
You kind of, I don't know. I'm on the fence. Like, let me ask you something. Let's play a little game real quick called Funny or Over the Line.
Okay.
All the shit with Ric Flair doing this shit. Funny or over the line?
Would you think it'd be over the line given his past? Is that why?
No, that's exactly what I'm saying.
I thought that too.
Given the airplane ride from hell.
Yeah, I know.
If there's anybody out there who is still traumatized from seeing his little dingus flopping around in that robe...
Yeah.
Then maybe it's over the line, but also I'm thinking, maybe you're being too sensitive. That's such a long time ago.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know. I think it's kind of fun. Like, it's supposed to be an adult animated show.
Yeah.
I think it's kind of funny, and it's like, oh, he's an old scumbag. I don't know. I think it's kind of funny.
It's interesting to see that he's willing to kind of make fun of himself.
Mm-mm.
So.
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
In that sense.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm looking forward to it. I mean, I really want to tear through the rest of the Edge and Christian episodes I haven't seen because some of that shit looks funny.
Yeah.
Some of that shit looks really funny.
I don't know if they're going to do a season two. Edge seemed kind of meh on the idea of doing season two.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Like in an interview or something? Like on the show?
No, in an interview.
Oh, okay. Did he say why? Like, what do you mean?
He just said it was a lot of work.
Oh, okay.
Well, so I guess he's, you know, executive producing and stuff like that.
Oh, okay.
So he's not just in it. He's writing and stuff.
I wonder how well like a performance does it does for this. I mean, that's gonna dictate it. Like if it does really, really well, they'll find a way to bring it back. So
Ulysses.
Hey there guys. My question this week is how many more opportunities do you believe AJ Styles will have at the WWE Championship?
Well, that's a really good question, Ulysses. I love this. It's only $20 a month and you can get your ugly face up here. How many more opportunities do you think AJ Styles have? I mean, do you know how long he's signed for? Hey, I'll say this about AJ Styles. He looks like he's having so much fun. And he's knocking it out of the park.
Yeah, he's doing a really good
job. He's in the main event scene. He's the biggest baby face they have right now. Like him and Dean Ambrose are kind of, but he's in the A-roll right now.
Yeah.
I kind of think the sky's the limit. I wasn't really sure going into it, what role they were going to have him play.
Yeah.
But given the reaction that he's got, and I honestly do think that they're going to go with Finn Balor and Anderson and Gallows. And I think they're going to keep AJ babyface.
Yeah. I agree.
And if that's the case, I think he'll get it within 24 months.
Yeah.
It honestly wouldn't surprise me if that moved up to like 12 months.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know. Like I could even see him winning Money in the Bank.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Like that'd be the first big.
I mean, if they really want to shock people, they'll have the Bullet Club reform with Styles and have him win it at Payback. It's not going to happen.
Yeah.
But they really want to shock people.
Yeah.
That'd be the way to do it.
Yeah. Anyways, thanks so much for your video questions, guys. Very much appreciated.
Yes, thank you.
And anybody else, $20 and up at the Patreon?
Yeah.
You guys can too.
Yep.
It's a lot of fun. All right, Larson, you know what time it is?
Time for Kayfabe Corner.
What is Kayfabe Corner, Larson?
It's only the greatest pro wrestling trivia challenge of all time.
That's what it is.
12 names, 6 real, 6 fake, typically.
Correct.
Sometimes mistakes happen.
Correct.
2 bonus questions.
Pretty sure all mine are, I think it's 6 and 6. Definitely have... 2 bonus questions.
What's the theme this week?
All right. So I gave the $10 and up patrons the option. China or X-Pac.
Say it correctly.
X-Pac. X-Night. They chose China. Kind of a close vote. Some people were trying. In the image that I use, I relegated. I sort of made X-Pac look smaller. Barely put his name on there, so they didn't even know like who it was. And next time, I need to do a better job of that. Of like disguising who it is, so the person I want to win. Some people were trying to hijack it.
Yeah.
And so X-Pac got, out of the 17 votes that came in, X-Pac got 7.
Wow.
China got 10.
That's kind of what happened last week.
Or 6 and 10. I think it was 6 and 10.
Last week as well.
Ooh.
Where I was surprised that the League of Nations won.
Ooh, boy. All right. Here we go. You ready?
Okay, yeah.
China is the theme. China. From the WWE.
Yeah.
Only Intercontinental Champion ever. Are you ready?
Sure.
Joni Dragon.
Fake.
Very good. Joni Mean.
Fake.
Very good. Joni Lee.
Real.
Very good. Ooh, on a tear. The Hard Luck Kid.
Fake.
Real. Alexandra Wright.
Alexandra?
Yeah.
Real.
Fake.
Damn.
Honey Boy Fargo.
Wow. See,
it's a great name.
Yeah, real.
It's very good. It is real.
You wouldn't have come up with that.
That's so rude. Lee Carter.
Fake.
Very good. Jesus, you're a 5 already? Woo, boy. Hazelip Squire.
Wait, what?
Hazelip Squire.
Real.
Fake.
Wow, good job.
Pac Chu.
Fake.
Real.
Oh, wow.
The Stroke.
Fake.
Very good. Alfonso Dantes.
Man, I lost track of reals and fakes.
Good. You can't be tracking these.
How many do we have left after this one? Or is this 12?
I'm not going to tell you that.
I tell you the number every time.
Really? Okay. It's this one and one more.
Okay. So 11. Yeah. What's the name again?
Alfonso Dantes.
Real.
Very good. Rhett Hart.
I want to say fake. But it might be real. I'll say fake.
I was going to give you this one regardless. It's a real person, a member of the Hart family. They could have been a wrestler, but their actual name was Rediger Hart. And so I.
But you don't know if they were an actual wrestler.
Yeah, you get it.
Okay.
All right.
That's 8.
Woo, 8. All right, here we go. This first one should be a gimme.
Okay.
Trivia questions.
Number 1.
Rhett Hart. Bart Hart.
Bart Hart.
Who trained China?
Killer Kowalski.
Very good. Very good.
9.
After China was in a car accident before she got into wrestling, she got a job selling something. What was it?
Fuck, I feel like I know this too. Nutritional supplements.
Beepers!
Oh, okay. I got 9.
Good job! Good job. Well done. Well done.
I think I'm up 4 now on the year.
Honey Boy Fargo. Hazelip Squire.
Who was Hazelip Squire?
I think it's the real... It's the real name of like a singer. Some other... Like a singer.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
What does that have to do with wrestling?
Oh, it's a loose connection. Okay. It's like China goes to something, goes to something, goes to the Hazelip Squire.
Okay.
Pac Chu. I like that one too. All right, anyways, that's K-Vape Corner. I don't know, you guys are still hanging around here. For you patrons offering up $5 or more, be sure to check out our bonus episode. It should be up very, very soon, if not already. Usually I do like this one, and then right on top of it, I do the other one.
Yeah.
So, check that out here at the Patreon. And otherwise, you got anything else for us? No? All right. We'll talk to you guys later.
Goodbye.
Be sure to hit that subscribe and download button on the podcast.
Yeah. That helps. Bye.